Hello again. Today I find myself in the book of Genesis, Genesis chapter 11, a passage of scripture that perhaps you've read before, but I've always wondered whether people really understand it. It's the story of the Tower of Babel. You remember that in this time prior to the birth of Abraham, right at the end of the antediluvian period, actually the flood had happened, so that we could call this the post-diluvian period. There is a story about these ancient people and how they gathered on the plain of Shinar, what we would call today Babylon, and they tried to erect a great big temple, or a great big pillar. We call it the Tower of Babylon, or the Tower of Babel. And in this particular passage, there are a couple of statements that are made that have always been very confusing to me. And so as I have thought about them and thought about them over and over again, I've come to some realization of what those particular passages probably mean. And that's what I want to share with you today. You'll notice there in verses 6 and 7, if you have your Bibles open, or you can consult them later, the scripture says there that that nothing that they, the people who had gathered there, propose to do now will be impossible for them. Now that's a very wonderful testimony about the ability of men made in the image of God to perform and to prove themselves and to invent and in many ways to serve Christ. But the very next verse says, let us confuse their language. That's always made me scratch my head. Why does God confuse their language just because they are able to do whatever they propose to do? I want to suggest to you that probably the reason for that has to do with the pride. Perhaps this was an example of idolatry. We don't really know, but men made in the image of God are truly amazing creatures. Just consider the technology that we have been able to develop. When I was young, I couldn't imagine carrying a computer in my pocket. I couldn't imagine computers, but I couldn't imagine carrying one in my pocket and using it to talk like I would on a telephone. We even call them phones. But that's what they are. They're really computers. And we carry them with us all the time. And that technology has just grown exponentially in the last few years. There was something about this Tower of Babel that fits into that. Because, you see, God says that nothing that they propose to do will be impossible to them. What we thought was impossible just a generation ago is commonplace today. And that's the world that we live in. Now, have you noticed how rapidly this technology has changed our world? It's changed us and how we live and move, but how it's changed the world around us. This particular generation knows nothing of earlier times when we didn't have those kinds of technology. But now we have that, and we have everything available at our fingertips. In chapter 11 of Genesis, the scripture talks about how God came and confused their language so that, the implication is, they wouldn't be able to do everything that was impossible to them prior to that. Now, at the fingertips of our computers, we have the ability to translate anything that we have written for us. I happen to have some friends that are on my Facebook account, and these people live in Chile, and so they write everything in Spanish. But there is a button right there. Whenever I want to read what they have to say, I just simply hit that button that says See Translation, and it comes up. It pops up. Have you noticed also that we live in a world where there's a push for a one-world government? Part of the judgment on the Tower of Babel was the diffusion of peoples into various nations around the world. And so all of these things are coming together right now. Essentially, we're undoing what God did in Genesis 11. Now, I'm not trying to suggest to you that nations were wrong. I'm not trying to suggest to you that technology is wrong and that we shouldn't use that. But somehow, perhaps the pride, the idolatry of men is what led God to confuse the languages and scatter the people. But now we're coming back together again. There are a lot of things in Scripture that suggest to me that the time of Jesus' return is soon. This just happens to be one of them. And I wonder, how soon will it be? Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you that one day you will return. Whether it's because we have figured out how to bring back a one-world government or a one-language world, I don't know. But I do know that you will return one day. And I thank you for moving in my own heart and the hearts of many who hear me to help us to put our trust and our faith in you. May you be truly honored in this generation, so that men will honor Christ and not raise up idols and raise up our own persons in defiance of you. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.